All right, let's continue our discussion on your research design module assignment. Last time, we talked about how you need to identify an issue at the company that you're working with. Any issue with regard to employees or customers will be fine. And you transform that issue and phrase it into a research aim. And then on the basis of that research aim, we ask you to formulate a central question and between 3 to 5 sub-questions for your design research study. So that's what you should have done by now. Today, we're going to continue our discussion for your module assignment in which you need to design a small-scaled research study. And let me reiterate, you only need to design the study, you don't need to actually perform it. In this session, we're going to cover 4 things: general research types, qualitative versus quantitative data, data collection instruments, and we will make a start on the topic of sampling. So after you have formulated your central problem statement and a few research questions, at this point, we can determine which type of research your designed research study actually is. For the purpose of this module, we categorize research into 3 general types: exploratory, descriptive, and causal. Let's take a look at what they all are. For exploratory research, the keyword here is explore. Think of great explorers in history. Let's take Climbus as an example. I am not a historian, but I understand the story to be when Climbus set out to explore the seas, he had no clear idea what he was going to find. For all he knew, he might find endless oceans, or he might encounter small islands, or he might actually discover a new land. But he did not know that for certain. He was not sure. He just wanted to explore. And he wanted to explore precisely because he did not know what was out there, precisely because he did not have a clear idea concerning what he might find. Essentially, this same idea applies to exploratory research. We perform exploratory research on subject matters about which we know rather little. And because of that, because we don't know much about it, because there isn't much literature on it, we cannot formulate specific hypotheses to test. We cannot conceptualize models to predict causality. All that we can do is to explore the subject matter. And that's why exploratory research is mostly qualitative. Because at this exploratory stage, there is rather little need to be accurate and precise. So this is all we need to know about exploratory research at this point. But if you're interested, I do have some other videos on qualitative research design, which I will link below in the description section and also in the end screen of this video. The second type of research we're going to talk about in this module is descriptive research. For this type of research, the keyword here obviously is describe. In other words, we perform descriptive studies to describe something. Generally speaking, we can only describe something about which we already know a little something about which there is already some literature and knowledge, but we want to know more. We want to be able to describe it better. We want to be more accurate and precise in our knowledge of it. And that's why we perform descriptive studies. As a result, descriptive studies are most of the time quantitative. There are exceptions, but most of the time, descriptive studies would use a quantitative approach. And that's because we want to be accurate and precise in our description of the subject matter on which we're performing the descriptive study. The third and last research type is causal research, not casual, but causal research. Causal research aims to identify or explain cause and effect relationships amongst different things or different variables. Causal research deals with questions like, how does A influence B? Or what is the effect of A on B? Sometimes it may involve more than just 2 variables. For example, how does X influence the relation between A and B? And in some causal models, like in certain structural equation models, we will see 10 or 15 variables all conceptualized in complex causal relationships. But regardless how many variables there are in a causal study or a causal model, the idea of causal research is to identify or explain cause and effect relationships. In your module assignment, after you have presented your issue, problem statement, and research questions, you need to clearly indicate which type of research your research study is. Is it exploratory, descriptive, or causal? And why you would characterize it as such. You also need to indicate in your assignment which type of data you intend to collect, qualitative or quantitative. Let's quickly recap what they are. We already discussed qualitative versus quantitative data in the research module of year 1, so we can quickly fly through this slide. Essentially, quantitative data are quantifiable, numerical, statistical type of information. They deal with the quantity of something and they are readily measurable. Qualitative data, on the other hand, is pretty much the opposite. They deal with things that are not readily measurable or quantifiable. They are non-numerical, they are generated and collected in the form of stories, narratives, sometimes even images or videos or drawings or whatever form that is not numerical or statistical. For the purpose of this module assignment, we ask you to choose one type of data for your design study. If you do feel that you actually need both kinds of data for your design study, you should talk to your consultation workshop teacher about it and see whether that is indeed logically required. And that is because, once again, for this paper, we would like you to design a research study that has a very clear and limited scope, which would require just one type of data. That is, if your study is exploratory, you probably should collect qualitative data. But if your study is descriptive or causal, then you should probably consider collecting quantitative data. Next issue, data collection instruments. So how do we gather these data? What are the tools that we can use in order to collect the empirical data that is needed to answer the research questions? So I'm going to cut away to another video in which I spoke about data collection instruments. In chapter 7 of the Brotherton book, he presents four main data collection instruments. The first one is surveying. Researchers can use different kinds of surveys, telephone-based surveys, internet-based surveys, or questionnaire-based surveys, but regardless of what the medium or channel the researcher uses, the idea behind surveys is to use a rather standardized instrument to collect rather standardized data from a relatively large number of respondents in a relatively short period of time. So when we build a survey, we need to consider the kind of questions or items that should be put into it. Generally speaking, surveys contain mostly closed questions, yes or no questions, multiple choice items, or Likert scale questions. There are two main reasons for using these types of questions and items in a survey. First, surveys are used to collect mostly quantitative data because surveying is primarily used for descriptive purposes. As a result, when we describe something, we generally have the intention of being accurate and precise, and as such, quantitative, measurable data is a good choice. Second, from a practical point of view, probably no one will bother to write lengthy answers in a survey for you. If somebody hands me a survey and it contains open questions to which I must write long, big essay type of answers, well, screw that person, I am simply not going to bother to fit it out. So, as a result of both theoretical and operational considerations, surveys typically use closed questions that respondents can answer relatively easily and quickly. There are a few important considerations when making survey questions or items. First, offering gradations is usually better than just yes or no. Instead of asking, do you like this or do you agree with this statement or not, we can better ask, to what extent do you like something or to what degree do you agree with a certain statement, and then offer a Likert scale. Not only such answers will more accurately reflect the opinion and the perception of the respondent, they also offer more possibilities in terms of data analytical methods. Another consideration for creating survey items is really just to use your common sense. For instance, if the phraseology of the survey items are highly leading or really provocative, then we can almost be certain that the respondents won't be able to provide us with highly reliable data. Also, sometimes I come across surveys with multiple choice items, but the multiple choices do not even include all the possibilities that may exist. For example, if they ask me, do you drink water or do you drink wine with dinner? Well, what if I drink beer, which is not even included as an option? So really, a lot of the suggestions that this chapter offers are just common sense. So use your common sense. The second data collection instrument that this chapter discusses is interviewing. Interviews can be structured, semi-structured, or unstructured. Brotherton also categorizes focus groups under interviewing in this chapter. If surveys are typically used to collect standardized quantitative data, interviewing is pretty much on the other end of the spectrum. Interviews are typically used to collect qualitative data. Consequently, during interviews, only or mostly open questions will be asked. Instead of asking, do you like research, we should be asking, what do you think about research? Can you talk about what research means to you? What is your opinion regarding doing research as a bachelor student, etc.? Because qualitative data collection is typically associated with exploratory research, we are not interested in getting just a yes or no answer or a Likert scale answer. We want to trigger qualitative answers, previously unknown perspectives. We want to let new issues surface through interviewing. That is why we want to ask open questions and we want to ask follow-up questions. We ask clarifications. We ask the respondents to tell us more, to explain and elaborate further. That is the goal of interviewing. The third data collection instrument that this chapter talks about is observation. Researchers can conduct observation in different manners, covert or overt, qualitative or quantitative, as a mere observer or as a participant, in a controlled lab setting or in the field. As the researchers typically conduct the observation themselves, they can easily determine how best the observation should be done in line with the specific objectives of a particular research study. As such, observation is quite a versatile data collection instrument which can be used in all research types: exploratory, descriptive, and causal. The final data collection instrument that this chapter discusses is projective techniques. So the idea here is to show or project some kind of stimulus, either vague or rather explicit, to the respondent, and you ask the respondent to respond to that stimulus. For instance, if I show you an image of some sort and ask you to associate it with a hospitality-related experience, and then ask you to describe that experience, this would be considered a projective technique. The Brotherton book presents this instrument as typically used for collecting qualitative data, and it mentions five main types of usage of this instrument. Associate, show a stimulus and ask the respondent to associate it with something. Completion, show the respondent a stimulus that is incomplete and ask them to complete it. Construction, ask the respondent to construct something on the basis of the stimulus shown. Expressive, ask the respondents to express their feelings and emotions on the basis of the stimulus shown. And choice ordering, ask the respondents to order the shown stimulus on the basis of importance or preference or some other type of criterion. So, for the purpose of this assignment, we ask you to choose one data collection instrument for your design study. If you require qualitative data, then go with one of the qualitative data collection instruments, such as interviewing or qualitative observation or focus group. If you need quantitative data, then choose one of the quantitative data collection instruments, maybe surveys or experiment or quantitative observation. The last thing we want to talk about in this session is sampling. I like to just make a start on the topic of population sample and sampling. Let me present you with a rough definition of what they are so that you can start to think about, for the research study that you're designing, what should be your population, sample, and sampling method. So if you don't mind, I am going to cut away to another video again. We start by defining population, sample, and sampling. Simply put, a research population refers to all the people about whom we want to draw our conclusions. A sample is the group of people from within that population from whom we actually collect data. And sampling refers to the process through which we draw the sample out of the population. For instance, if my main research question is, what do hotel school students in Leeuwarden think about PBL? Then obviously the research population would be all the hotel school students in Leeuwarden, which would be about 2,000 people. But for my study, I will only collect data from 200 students. Then this 200 students will be my sample. And the process or procedure through which I choose the 200 students out of the 2,000 is known as sampling. All right, so to sum up, today we discussed three general research types: exploratory, descriptive, and causal. We talked about qualitative versus quantitative data. We looked at four main data collection instruments, and we made a start on the topic of population sample and sampling, which means you may now further design your study for the purpose of your module assignment. Thank you very much for watching this Ranywayz random video, and please like and subscribe, and I will see you next time.